Hello and welcome to this discussion on the COVID-19 pandemic and the need for bosses to think the unthinkable in order to adapt, survive and ultimately thrive. And we're joined today with Nik Gowing. Nik is the founder of the Unthinkable Project, or the Thinking the Unthinkable Project rather, and he's the co-author of the book Thinking the Unthinkable, published in 2018. Nik is a renowned and awarded international journalist with a long and distinguished career with the BBC, and he's also part of ADC Forum's international faculty. Nik is talking to leaders constantly around the world, understanding the challenges of our ever-disrupted world and helping leaders to navigate the array of dimensions from the geopolitical, the economy and its markets, the public information space, and the ramifications across society. So Nik, what are you seeing as the world lurches once again into the unknown with COVID-19 and our leaders from business and more broadly rising up to the challenge?
Well, there are some good morning, good evening, good afternoon in Australia. I'm in London this morning, where obviously we're facing a new challenge of what the condition of the Prime Minister is. But the challenge really, Anton, is the following, and for everyone who's watching, is the fact that what you are facing, what we are facing, is something which was unthinkable, or was it actually unpalatable? And I make that distinction because in the work that I've been doing for the last 6 years, identifying the unthinkables that had to be thought about, it's actually the unpalatable which has been central to all of this. Because much of what you're seeing now was actually predicted, was actually on risk registers for those who really wanted to actually think that this was now a possibility. Now, you may think that that's a bit extreme, but what we're seeing at the moment is essentially an existential threat. It's easy to say that for our project to say no leaders are really getting this. I don't think that's totally the case at all. I think there are some remarkable initiatives among leaders who are really gripping the enormity of what is happening. But for most, it's come like a bolt out of the blue. It is about survival. I'm now telling you what you already know. But Anton, you'll remember that I gave a presentation at Gold Coast at the ALR, the leadership retreat, a couple of years ago. And I think people thought I was, along with Greg Copley, that we were somehow smoking something, as if, no, we are the leaders and we will find out, we will know how best to handle anything that is thrown at us. Well, now, tragically, since January and February, you've seen the enormity of what can happen when actually what was warned about, certainly in the World Economic Forum and the risk report and elsewhere, a pandemic has actually happened, not in a kind of leisurely way, in a way which is precipitous. And what you're seeing is, tragically, many leaders who've literally been hit between the eyes as if knocked out by boxing gloves because they weren't prepared to consider that this was a possibility. You may say, well, it's easy to say that after the event, but our work certainly, and I'm going to show you this, not just to show you that we've written about it, but it's that image from the front cover of the World Today, which is the journal of the Royal Institute for International Affairs in London. Those leaders who are blindfolded to think the unthinkable. It's that blindfolding, which is why I'm putting that up there as an image for you to take away. The blindfolding, the myopic view that many leaders have had about, well, this is the way we've been running our company. This is the way we've been doing things. This is the way, actually, we'll still get away with it. Our main findings are the following from our project, and I want you to think very carefully about whether this actually applies to you. The conformity which qualifies leaders for the top in many ways disqualifies them now from appreciating the scale of disruption, the enormity of it, how to handle it, and then what to do about it. Conformity. Now, that when you look at what executive search firms are doing, kind of way in which boards are looking at the way they employ people, it tends to be whether in writing or in their minds, according to a pretty predictable checklist, a checklist of this is the way we think we need to be going. But what you're seeing is a very, very narrow risk register in most companies, whether large, medium or small. a very narrow risk register, because that conformity is not allowing leaders at the top, particularly those who are publicly quoted, to think more laterally about what the potential threats are to them, hoping that one day it'll go away, or it won't be there to be considered, or, well, I'll be a chief executive for 3 or 4 more years, it won't happen on my watch, I can still take my share options and I can still have a significant revenue from this. No, what you're talking about is a precipitate threat and challenge to everything that we've taken for granted. And to pick up on your question, Anton, it is about an existential threat, because I don't have to tell you now, there's a liquidity challenge, a massive liquidity challenge for every single leader, unless you are in a company or in an organization which has enormous liquid assets, which can tide you over for some time to come. This is an existential threat, simply because people, leaders, companies, institutions, and I include government in all of this, work on the basis that, okay, we will have a budget, we know where our income is coming from, we've got the framing of what our customers want, who our customers are, and that will keep us going for a certain length of time. What you've seen is that hit in an enormous way. My final thought at this point, Anton, is the following. It's easy to dismiss mavericks in a company or in an institution like public service in Canberra or each of the states. It's easy to dismiss mavericks as kind of nuisances, people who can be shoved aside. I would put to you that actually mavericks tend to be visionaries. They need to be given a voice. They need to be given time. They need to be respected and not marginalized, because they don't fit a kind of template. Because many of those who are mavericks actually can be seen to be the people who are thinking more broadly, more energetically, more adventurously. And don't dismiss either the views of the next generation, however you want to define them, generation X, Y, Z, or whatever you want to call them. Often those within a company who are the next generation have been marginalized or told to just keep down until your time has come. I would put to you that this is a really serious challenge to you, but also an opportunity. You can adapt, survive, and thrive by bringing in more people into your decision making. In our work of Thinking the Unthinkable with companies, large, small, public services, government services, we tell people that they can adapt, survive, and thrive, and by doing that they can move forward. And how do you do that? You have humility, and you also have difficult conversations with your staff, people around you. Make it clear that you as leader may not know the answers then, and you know that. And therefore, embracing, bringing in, and making it super inclusive. It won't necessarily fill your bank account with cash, but it will probably allow you to have survival. When I see what has been happening in Canberra, certainly during the fires and elsewhere, when I look at what is happening in every government, whether in Germany, whether in the United Kingdom, whether in France, whether in Brazil, look at what is now happening in India as well. Those at the top who believed that they were somehow safe from the unthinkables, safe from the unpalatables, have really been hit between the eyes by the fact that much of what is happening was simply never on their radar screen, and they've struggled. They are struggling. And sadly, I think there is going to be a very high price. The world we have taken for granted is not going to be the world of the future. And that is the kind of assumption that whoever you are watching this webcast, you have to assume, work out how you can be not panicked by this, but see it as a real opportunity, even though the parameters are deeply, deeply troubling. It may sound easy to say this now, several weeks into the crisis, but I have to say, in our work, we've been warning about it. And most people wondered if we were smoking something. Sadly, we've now got to that point, Anton, where what we've been alerting people to, thinking about this, thinking about unthinkables and unpalatables, has happened, has hit them between the eyes. Now they're trying to work out at very high speed how to somehow ameliorate the situation. It's very tough.
Nik, you spoke about one of the great dangers within organizations and institutions being conformity and the narrowness of the risk register. And I'm wondering whether, you know, is there a greater reconsideration of values that needs to take place in a lot of these organizations, or is that too simplistic a reference?
Well, I put to you that reevaluation of values is great at the moment, but that's a long-term prospect, and long-term is actually only a few weeks, maybe a couple of months. This is, as I say, it's an existential issue. So yes, values, but actually I would put it down to mindset, behavior, how you approach this. And we are now several weeks into the crisis, and already many companies are bleeding badly, barely surviving at the moment. They're lucky to have survival, and they also have those working for them are probably struggling as well, wondering if they're going to have any salary, any wages, wondering where the next food is going to come from. It literally is like that. So with all due respect, Anton, it's all very well talking about values, but it's one of the main values. And I think Paul Polman, the former chief executive of Unilever, has got it absolutely right in about a minute 15 on a tweet a couple of weeks ago. He said many companies in their future for survival are going to be judged by how they handle this, not by the profit and loss account, but about how they go out into the community and help as much as they can, not worrying about the profit and loss and the quarterly returns. So if your question is about values and that is a value, then I would say that requires a change of the value, which is what are we here for? And it brings us back to a much more, a much deeper discussion about purpose and values, which, as you know, has been underway for some time. But now it's coming and hitting leaders fully in the face again. What is your purpose? What are your values and your values and your purpose and how you will survive through this? What is your purpose? I would put to you that the purpose for most companies at the moment is to survive and also be shown to have a value, which is a value to the community, but a value to your customers and a value also for public servants, to those who've elected those they are serving. It's deeply troubling. Yes, values, most certainly, but move down the track a little faster and think more abruptly about how humble you're going to be, how self-critical you have to be, and also how aware you are of what everyone around you is thinking. Because what we're seeing, I think, is some extraordinary initiatives which many people can learn from, of initiatives of how they've understood as leaders what needs to be done, how to handle this, and how to move forward in order to preserve the cash, but also to preserve the people who are working for you. If that's about value,
that's a real conundrum, isn't it, Nik? Because when you spoke of the liquidity challenge, that in itself being an existential risk, but I mean, having the value of the company, its purpose being about survival and also being the contribution to the community. I mean, what we're really looking at also is the function of demand, and that's just fallen off a cliff. And not every organization presumably is going to be able to be in a position to, one, have a purpose that necessarily meets that future demand, or that necessarily, you know, squares things off their own survival. So are you seeing leaders that are running scared in this situation because of COVID-19?
Well, let me backtrack a little bit, if I may, Anton. Our work over the last 6 years has involved interviewing many leaders at the highest levels, very confidentially. We're not giving any names out. And many have confirmed how scared and overwhelmed they already were. You've been through this with your banking crisis in your country, and the Royal Commission and so on. But it's not the role of a leader to admit how scared and overwhelmed they are and were. Why do I say that? Because you're talking about a framing already where stability, as we warned about at the beginning of this year, is unraveling. And that was already meaning that many leaders were worried about how they were going to survive the change in the geopolitical landscape, the change in the economic realities, the change in demand from the next generation, the speed at which that was changing. COVID-19 is now something which is on top of that. It's a layer on top of it, a formidable, insidious, precipitate layer on top of it. So my answer to your question is they were already scared and overwhelmed in many ways, not least in publicly quoted companies, from the fact that regulators were getting tighter and tighter and tougher and tougher on regulation at a time when the realities of running a business are already becoming very different. So you're talking about a pincer movement here, Anton, where it's not just COVID-19. COVID-19 has come on the top of fear and being scared about the situation, which was already an endemic part of being in business. Of course, there are many who are functioning very well. Investment bankers, the Black Rocks, the Blackstones, and so on, have been doing fantastically well. But remember what those at the top were saying. Things are changing very fast, and we've got to adapt quickly. Now, we've got to adapt not just quickly, but hugely rapidly.
We've got a number of questions from online, and I would encourage our listeners to put in their questions online, and we can ask those to Nick as well. We've got one from Ian Dunlop, where he refers to the mantra that's been going around over the last few years around resilience. And he asked the question, resilience to what? And are there any leaders, in your opinion, Nick, who understand the fact that human civilization, as he says, is faced with existential threats?
Yes, I think good afternoon. There are two questions there on resilience. Well, every company has to assume resilience is central to the way it's working. Every government has to think that way as well. I think that is at risk at the moment. I think purpose and reputation are at risk, tragically, because of what has happened. Because actually, those at the top, for reasons that I've just said, those at the top do not want to think beyond their conformist boundaries. I think, and I don't obviously know what your own role is, but resilience is about having an understanding of risk in your mind, which goes well beyond the very narrow risk register that tend to be the way risk is assessed at the moment. So yes, look, I run a company, I run the Thinking the Unthinkable company with my colleague Chris Langdon, but we have to worry about our own resilience. So I'm not speaking as a journalist, I'm speaking as someone who's running a profit and loss account and understands exactly what you're talking about. Secondly, the idea of existential, I have to say, yes, this is now an existential threat and challenge to everything we have taken for granted. I could quote to you page 211 of our book, where we quote Joe Kaeser, who is the global chief executive of Siemens. And I would quote him in detail saying exactly this, that there is an existential threat with governments, with society, the glue that holds, as he put it, the glue that holds society together, being at risk. Now, one of the reasons I mentioned Joe Kaeser, of course, is that he is chief executive of Siemens, and they were involved and have been involved very controversially in the Adani mine. And that has now been given the go-ahead with an 18 million euro contract for just the signaling on the railway line. And he was already, I saw him in Abu Dhabi at the beginning of January at the Masdar Global Sustainability Summit, talking about the difficulty of being a leader now with all the pressures on you. That was before what we now have. So yes, we are talking about an existential threat where tragically we are going to see an existential reality which is going to be deeply, deeply humbling but also brutal unless governments can intervene in a way which will save many companies. And certainly here in the United Kingdom, the new Chancellor of the Exchequer, excuse me, has said that only probably 95% companies will benefit from the kind of measures that they've got. But it is existential, and it is existential for the way in which we live our lives. There will not be as much consumer demand, and you talk about demand there. There will not be as much consumer demand. This has to be the assumption. I was on a webinar yesterday with the London School of Economics, and the outlook being painted by two very senior economists, I can't name them because it was off the record, was deeply, deeply troubling. I saw Ian Stewart, the UK economist, chief economist for Deloitte UK, warning yesterday, talking about in the United Kingdom, certainly up to a 20 to 30% contraction of the economy in one quarter. These are mind-boggling parameters, and that surely has to be existential, because everyone who believes they still have a way to earn money, that money may not be able to be coming in future. Surely that is existential. It's human. It is like a human pandemic.
Nick, there's a couple of questions here. I'm going to put them together. One is around the sort of risks that leaders need to take at this point in time. Are they do businesses need to fully pivot on their business models to new business models in this environment? Is that what survival means, or is it something that's incremental? And the second question relates again back to the previous one a little bit, which is around the sustainability of the broader economic system, and talking about the fog of short-termism and myopic ideologies. That's from Ian as well. And do you see this changing globally, even with the impetus of emergency action to address the virus? So the first question is around, does survival mean you have to fully pivot your business model to a new model? And does the virus, the emergency of the virus, will that necessitate change to a longer term approach to the economy?
Well, first of all, the second question, if I may, Anton, virus pivoting to a long-term, a different long-term view. Think very carefully, and if I had slides here, I'd be showing you. Think about what the long-term is. The long-term is probably a few days from now, maybe a couple of weeks if you're lucky. The long-term is not in 5 to 10 years, it's in 5 to 10 months, 5 to 10 weeks. So recalibrate what you think over the long-term, because there's no point thinking about 10 years from now if you're actually worried about whether you'll be surviving 10 days from now. I'm going to quote Jim Hagemann-Snabe, who's currently the chairman of both Siemens and also A.P. Moller, the giant container firm Maersk. And he and Mikhail Troller wrote a great book at the same time as us called Dreams and Details. And they both say very, very clearly, this has to be goodbye business plan. And that's my answer to you, because it's not about necessarily the model. The model you are using is probably out of date and totally irrelevant now. It's how you use that humility to adapt, survive, and thrive. So yes, models, as we've taken them and assumed them, are, in our view, you have to assume they are no longer relevant. I'd put to you that much of what is being taught in business schools is out of date. Even if there are if there's anyone from a business school watching, business schools, and I know from talking to several in the last few weeks, are bleeding badly because actually their relevance at a time like this, teaching models of economic and commercial activity, is seen to be far less because they haven't adapted yet in any way, shape or form to the new existential reality we face. So long term, short term, models dead. And as I underscore what Jim Snabe and Michael Troller have written in their great book, Dreams and Details, goodbye business plans.
Nick, there's a question from Daniel Van Asvegen, who mentions that he was at the session a couple of years ago and that the predictions around thinking the unthinkable, well, those unthinkables have come to pass. And he sort of asked the question whether, you know, our leaders thinking about, you know, could there be, what if there's a second virus? What if there's another pandemic? What if there's another unthinkable on top of this one? Or is this realm of unthinkables that we're living through, is this the new normal? I mean, what does the new normal even mean as a phrase, right? Everyone's talked about the new normal over the last 10 years, every couple of years when something new has happened. But this is, what is this situation? How do you describe it?
The new normal is disruption. The new normal is challenging every single assumption you make running a company or even running government. I can answer your question about the virus in this way. Dr. David Nabarro is a senior envoy to the World Health Organization. I've been on several webinars with him, and he and many other epidemiologists, we can argue, or they can argue, about which way it's going. And remember, COVID-19 was not known about 4 months ago. So everyone is in a state of rapid exploration, looking at the data. There's changes going on. But he says very clearly, what people have got to assume is that there will be pockets, at least pockets, emerging of COVID-19. We've got one with 1,900 people in a village outside Rome at the moment. Even though in Italy, in Northern Italy, things are pretty terrible. But yes, you have to assume that this is something which is going to hit communities, both large and small, in pockets or larger pockets or communities or across a country frequently now, until it's clear the nature of COVID-19. I'm not an epidemiologist, I'm not a doctor, but I'm quoting to you what David Nabarro says, and he is very clear about this, that you've got to have a new steady state for how to handle COVID-19, assuming it's going to come back, affecting demand for your goods, affecting demand for your company, affecting your ability to operate again. It's about going back to the previous question from Ian about how you create resilience in this environment so you're not hit for six when this reemerges. So tragically, you're asking a very good question that we ain't anywhere yet. We're at the beginning of a very, very sinister curve of uncertainty. Mm.
I certainly take on board what you're saying in terms of the compression of time. The long term doesn't mean 2, 5, 10 decades down the track. It means the next few months, because events are happening so, so quickly. But in your conversations with some of the leaders you've been talking to, are any of them starting to paint a picture of what it might look like for them, or what the world might look like for them after the pandemic? Are there any early signs of nothing?
When is after the pandemic? I don't think you can assume that at all. I don't see that. I don't need to repeat what I've already said. What you're seeing is innovation. You're seeing inventiveness. You're seeing real, like a good military commander, like a really good public servant, thinking imaginatively and taking a risk. And that's what our work has been about even before this happened, trying to find stories of those who've taken risks, sometimes failed, but have pulled back and then gone down another track. With all due respect, Anton, I don't think you can talk about when COVID is over. This is now a level of instability which most people have never encountered in their lives, a level of adversity that most have never encountered. That has to be the working assumption, and it's going to require incredibly stiff resolve. But here, certainly here in the United Kingdom, and certainly what we're hearing is real social problems which are emerging already in this environment. The danger of loneliness, what you're seeing in families, what you're seeing with social cohesion being torn apart, families now being affected because men, husband and wives are having to spend too much time with each other, not in vast plots out in the outback, but actually in small flats and so on. It's these kind of social things which are also going to affect the ability of people, the self-confidence of people to believe that they still have a job and a way of earning money. And what you're seeing at the moment and hearing is the cries for, I have no money to buy food.
Nick, we're painting a pretty pessimistic picture and arguably a realistic picture.
No, realistic. It's neither pessimistic or optimistic. Good leadership is about being realistic in this.
Sure.
And as we've just heard from someone who heard me, forgive me, I've got to remember who it was, who heard me on the Gold Coast 2 years ago, it's about being realistic. It's not about being pessimistic or optimistic.
But in this realism, one of the viewers asks the question, for their business, should they go now or wait out the pandemic in the hope that things might turn around? What would you say to that?
This is from Chris Barry, I think, hello, Chris. Well, I don't want to say whether businesses should go now. That's for them to make a judgment on with their bankers and with their cash flow. Certainly here in the United Kingdom, and there's a pretty generous scheme for loans backed by the Chancellor of the Exchequer, in other words, the Finance Minister. But the trouble is people can't get hold of these loans because banks are overwhelmed at the moment. And certainly there's a sense of why take out a loan if actually all you're doing is prolonging and delaying the inevitability of probably my company not surviving, because the reality will be so dreadful. There'll be no demand, no suppliers, no cash flow, and my bills are not being paid. I'm not getting paid for what I've supplied. What's the point? And why have a loan around your neck? At least in the United Kingdom, they've given a lower limit of £250,000, below which you do not have to use your property and your capital goods as surety. But £250,000 can disappear very quickly. So, Chris, my answer to you is, I think there are a lot of people who are beginning quietly to think of it's better to pack up than actually just incur even greater debt. This is the brutal nature of the spiraling down that we're now seeing potentially within global economies. And I think, and I can't tell you which two economists we're talking about, but there was a real sense yesterday on this call with the London School of Economics that globalization is coming to an end. Who is going to be championing free trade in this new environment? It's going to be about protectionism, and that's going to slow down the global economy even more. And for you in Australia, that's going to be devastating.
And I guess it's what things will be globalized and what things will not be. Certainly some of the conversation online is reflecting what you've just said about, you know, strategies and approaches to businesses to do things sooner that you see coming down the line rather than waiting. Just a question around government. Do you see government reclaiming some of its lost status and role going forward? I mean, you won a BAFTA for your Cold War coverage of martial law in Poland in 1982. And where do you see the dangers of government overreach now in terms of reacting to COVID-19? And how do you see things panning out into this timeline that we can't talk about because it's so uncertain and indeterminate?
Governments are going to save these economies. They're not going to save them in the way that we have got used to them. But this is about the state coming back. And I'm quoting here other economists. This is a reality here. Look what's happened in a free market, pretty radical right-wing new government with a large majority here in the United Kingdom. It's about state intervention, and that's what we're seeing right across the European Union. In Hungary, it's gone to even greater lengths with Viktor Orban, the prime minister, ruling by decree. You're seeing a return of the state. You're seeing a return of the state because the state is needed to essentially print money to save the economy. And that is coming through loud and clear from many of those that we're talking to. Everyone, including those who are arch free marketeers, are saying the government, the state, needs to help us bail ourselves out, or to give us at least a lifeline in the hope that we can bail ourselves out. So this is a massive, massive change. And for those who are free marketeers and those who believe in the free market, this is an extraordinary turnaround. But here we've got Boris Johnson tragically fighting for his life in a London hospital, having been put into intensive care. But his government was voted in on the basis not just of Brexit, but of free market economies and free market economic instincts. And now you've got something very different happening, certainly in the United Kingdom and many other countries that I've quoted. So it's a big, big change. And this at a time when, quote, we are heading for a global depression. Heading for a global depression on the scale that we saw in World War II. I'm being a realist here, and I'm quoting others, but that's what you have to bear in mind. If I'm wrong and you come back to me in a year's time and say you're far too pessimistic, great, but you've got to be realistic and see that as an option at the moment, the unthinkable and the unpalatable.
It's certainly a very dark realism, Nick, and I think a lot of the people online listening to us now and contributing to this conversation are leaders themselves. But it's in this abyss of the unknown, it's sometimes hard to find inspiration even from within ourselves. I would ask you, given your coverage and your scanning of what's going on in the world at the moment, are there any places that we can look now for inspiration, whether it's from leaders, from you know, particular writers from history? What are the sources of inspiration at the moment?
Well, I think you can take inspiration from Singapore and Korea to a certain extent. And ironically, Taiwan, where there's been a very, very low rate of infection and very low rate of deaths compared to what's happening in mainland China. It is down to, I quoted Paul Polman, I quoted several other leaders who are really taking the initiative, using the cash resources they've got, using the staff and the human capacity they've got to think in an inclusive way to engage. But I think, Anton, we are at a stage of basic human survival. It's a bit like Lord of the Flies, William Golding, where visceral instincts of how am I going to survive through this, even in an urban environment, in ways which no one ever believed that they would have to face, are center frame in all of this. And I think any idea of being theoretical about this for the next few weeks should be marginalized and set aside, because we are talking about tribal instincts. And I think one of the appalling sides of this is how nasty and selfish some people are being, particularly in supermarkets. We're seeing, certainly in the United Kingdom, of retailers being, of shop assistants being spat at for telling people to stand 2 meters apart and so on. We are seeing, and I apologize if I'm offending anyone who's watching this, but we're seeing certain instincts which have voted in President Trump and also voted for Brexit here in the United Kingdom, that kind of selfishness in many ways, which is now being tested and coming to the fore, and I've seen it in person. And that is what's worrying. Those of you who've worked abroad and maybe worked in the armed forces and have seen what happens in wartime, and we are in a state which is equivalent to wartime, not at war, but equivalent to wartime, that tests people and leaders and everyone and community to extremes. We're seeing the most fantastic expressions of commitment, but we're also seeing some dark sides of human behavior, which one only thought one read about books from history, but no, it's still here.
Are you suggesting, Nik, that when we come away from this discussion, that if we're going to take one thing with us, that could that be that we need to be ethical mavericks, that we go back into our organizations, that we go back into society as ethical mavericks? How would you summarize what we need to do as leaders to coming away from this?
That's a good phrase. That's a good phrase. Ethical mavericks. Yeah, humble mavericks as well, or someone who leads humble mavericks. Mm. But again, not wanting to be classed as a pessimist, but a realist. One of the things that's coming through, and I realize this is a delicate issue or a controversial issue in Australia, is what's going to happen on the climate emergency. Because I think, and I'm reflecting on a large number of conversations, there are those who say with COVID-19, it's a dry run for the climate emergency coming down the track. And while in many ways, COP26 has now been postponed, it was due to take place in November in Glasgow, it's now been postponed for practical reasons because the conference center has been turned into a massive hospital facility in Glasgow. While that has been delayed, it's indicative of how the climate emergency has now been put to the backs of minds. And certainly people in government I've been talking about have been saying that climate emergency is not even on our agenda. We don't have the people to even think about it now because it's about the survival of our system and our society. So yes, ethical mavericks is a good idea, but I come back to what I was just saying about how with the climate emergency and the global necessity to do something urgently about this, the urgency has not gone away. And it's about how society, politicians, public servants, and corporate leaders are going to adjust to the fact that this is a first run for the kind of enormity of challenges with increases in temperature, which we are seeing. And my goodness, you've been through it in certain parts of Australia with the fires in December and January. This is part of a matrix of massive challenges to our societal balance that we've never, ever seen, apart from in wartime.
Well, Nik, it's been one more shot across the bow. And, you know, as we head into the unknown future in this sort of dark realism that you're painting, let's hope that we can actually head in a direction where we can survive and ultimately thrive. It's been fantastic.
Can I just say what I'm doing, and you've asked me to do, is bring together a lot of evidence. It's not just about me and thinking the unthinkable. It's trying to use thinking the unthinkable to encapsulate a positive way forward to adapt, survive and thrive. So what I've done as best I can is also quote experts. Mm-hmm. So it's not me being gloomy. It's experts warning about the reality, the data reality, the scientific realities out there, which we've all got to contend with now.
Well, Nik, thanks very much. It's been very insightful. And along with the listeners, thank you very much for joining us.
My pleasure. And thank you, everyone, for joining.